Good morning, folks. I think we're familiar with the hymn Standing on the Promises of God because we're waiting on our computers, so you know that refrain. I want to invite you to stand and sing as we're able. Standing on the Promises. See how well you remember this hymn.
Let's sing.
Have a seat and welcome, folks, to worship this morning. We're glad you joined us here at Foothills. My name is Brad. I have the privilege of being the pastor here, and we're glad you joined us this morning. It's interesting, if I look down at my bulletin, my sermon title is Laying Down Our Need for Control. Mm-hmm. And boy, we put a lot of effort into planning Sunday mornings. We do. I know, Lene, you spent hours putting together this slide service, which we're hoping to get up here at some point, and these kind of things. But as much as we like to be in control, sometimes we're just not. Those things happen. So we move on, and God's got a hold of this thing, so I'm not at least a bit concerned. It's hot this morning. Captain Obvious here. It's hot this morning. I remember living down in North Carolina when the hurricane came through, and we lost power in our county for over 2 weeks. No electricity, no refrigerator, no lights, no air conditioning, no fans. I know what hot's like, and it stinks. I know what it's like not to have air conditioning and fans and those kind of things. But I'm glad we can. I gave you message notes, right? You can do this. Come to crafts, you can make a fan. We could always do that, I guess, yeah. So where are things going with the process of moving into the new building? They had the city council meeting on Monday evening. The council overwhelmingly approved the final piece that we were waiting on. So it's moving forward, but not the speed we would like. This actually reminds me of a joke, I guess. A turtle walks into a cafe, says, "Can I have a glass of water, please?" Gives him a glass of water, the turtle slowly walks out. Turtle comes in the next day, "Can I have another glass of water, please?" Gets the water and slowly begins to back out. A couple more days pass, the same exact thing. Turtle comes in, asks for water, gets water, leaves. Finally, on the fifth day, the owner says, "Listen, I know you've been coming here getting water every day. We have soda, we have food, we have all these different kind of things. You want to do something different?" The turtle yells out, "Not now, my house is on fire." Sometimes there's a sense of immediacy, but we're just moving at the speed of church, the speed of lawyers, the speed of school, the speed of the state, the speed of these kind of things. But we're moving forward, and I'm excited about that. One of the things it takes is your prayers, your commitment, your attendance, and your gifts of tithes and offerings. So we appreciate all of that and the ways that you can support the church. Before we take this morning's offering, the choir, through Linda, will sing. Let's just say a word of prayer. Lord God, I thank you for this day that you've given to us. Despite the heat, Lord, it's a beautiful day that you have made. We choose to rejoice and be glad in it. We pray, Lord, you work all things out for your good and for your glory today. We pray your blessings upon this morning's offering. Bless these gifts, Lord. Use them for your purpose. Equip your people to trust more and more in you. Bless them, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Malcolm. Thank you, Linda. Well done. Beautiful. After a time of prayer, the next song the choir will sing is called On Eagle's Wings, based on that beautiful, wonderful passage from Isaiah chapter 40. It says that God will rise us up on wings like eagles. We will run and not grow weary. We will walk and not become faint. God will sustain us. God will be all that we need. God is more than enough. Speaking of turtles, I used to have a picture in my office of a turtle on top of a fence post. And I used to look at that picture of a turtle on top of a fence post, and I was reminded he didn't get there by himself. Turtle couldn't possibly get up there by himself. Someone helped him. We all have someone who wants to help us. It's the Lord our God. He will rise us up on wings like eagles, will place us on high positions of joy and of life and of fruitfulness. We didn't get here by ourselves. I can't do any of this without everyone, all of you involved. It takes a church. It takes a people who trust and believe in God. Yes, we love to think that we're in control. We want to be in control, but it's ultimately out of our control. It's God who we worship. So we pray to him. We lift up our concerns. We lift up our requests, our words of thanksgiving unto God who cares and loves each one of us. So I invite you this morning to bring those concerns, those sad moments, those moments of frustration or anxiety that you just give them to the Lord. For all your questions that are unanswered and things you're uncertain about, give those things to the Lord. The Lord who will pick you up and place you. We have a better perspective of things. Let's pray together. Lord our God, we come before you acknowledging that you are the high and lifted up Lord. The great is your faithfulness, great is your love towards us. You indeed, Lord, are worthy of all of our worship. You reign supreme over all things. We thank you, God, that you looked upon each of us and saw our estate and chose to come alongside us, to strengthen us, to lift us up. We didn't get anything without you. You are the provider of every good and perfect gift. All the abilities we have and the talents and the work that we do and all of our accomplishments, God, are because of your help and your intervention. We thank you for all of it, God. And we are a most needy people. We know, God, we have concerns and things that are beyond our ability to control. And so, Lord, let us just place those things today in your hands. Ask that you would intervene. You would do what only you can do. We pray for healing where healing is needed in our bodies and our relationships and our churches and our marriages. Bring healing, Lord, to the body of Christ. Touch the places that are broken, that need amending. Bless our relationships. Bless, God, the marriages. Bless our business associates. Bless our friends and the work that they do. Bless our neighbors, God, the strangers who are yet unwelcomed, the least, the last, the lost, those who you care about, God. We pray for financial needs that would be met. Lord, you're able to, more than able to provide for us. We pray for our country. We pray for the wars that continue to rage around the world. We pray for the millions of refugees who are seeking safe haven. We pray, God, for our denomination. We pray for this upcoming move. We pray, God, that you continue to work out all details to give us a hope and a future. Bless this time. God, bless each person. Hear us as we pray the prayer you taught each of us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Today's scripture reading comes from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 13. I'll be reading from the New International Version of the Bible. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I've learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. Praise God.
So Art, you rang the bell, read the scriptures, sang in the choir. Are you preaching too? No. How about we do one more song called Trust and Obey? Certainly, if you can, join us on all of it, but certainly on the chorus part. Trust and Obey. Let's stand and sing together.
Thank you.
Amen. You may have a seat. Stuck with it, Maggie. Good for you. I think you have your message notes. Looks something like this. It's something to write with a pen, a pencil, a marker. We're in the second week of a series I'm calling Alter Ego. An altar is something in the Old Testament where you lay it down to offer it to God. Ego is what we think of ourselves. Some of us have a too high opinion of ourselves. Some have a too low opinion of ourselves. Unfortunately, we need to get a more accurate picture of who and whose we are. So this message series, I'm going to lay down different characteristics. You know, last week we started taking some notes and we talked about our need, laying down our need for inadequacy. We feel inadequate oftentimes. And so we learned last week to remember that God sees more in us than we see. God has given us more than we think. God knows more about us. And it's less about us than we think. It's more about God. God just needs a willing participant. Today we'll talk about our need for control. Next week will be a right to be offended. And last week we'll learn with longing for approval, which is the big issue. We want everyone else's approval instead of the Lord's approval. So let's get started. Let's jump into this thing. Maybe we can start here. How many of you in some area of your life like to be in control? Just raise your hand up. Now, if you find yourself reaching for the person's next to your hand, you probably have it's probably for you, right? This is a message. I think we all kind of struggle with this. It's interesting, though. Everybody that I know, it seems like we're trying to control some area of our life. There's some particular pockets where we're really control freaks in those areas, and there are other areas where we really aren't really that concerned at all, it would seem. For example, some of you are really controlling at work. I mean, everything's got to be just the way you want it at work, but at home, you're just kind of laid back. You know, you may be sitting next to someone who's the exact opposite of you. Maybe at home, it's got to be this way or die, but at work, they're not so much concerned about things. Maybe you're very controlling about your finances. You need to know where every single penny is going, and when it comes to your children, you kind of just let them run off and do their own thing. You're concerned about money, but maybe not about your own kids. You have control in some areas and not so much in other areas. And to me, that's just interesting. And we look at our lives, we find we typically try to control two main areas of our life. We try to control, number one, go two slides up. We try to control people, and write that down, people. And we try to control, one more slide, two more slides. Boom, right there, circumstances. We try to control people and circumstances. We try to control people, right? Maybe there's someone in your life where there's one or two things about them you just don't like. So you want to help them see what you see, and then want to help them to get to do what you want them to do. Right? You want to control that person. So without even knowing it, we try to manipulate the behavior of other people. Because we really believe we know what's best for them. We want to be in control of those people around us. Maybe it's your coworkers. Maybe it's the people who work for you. Maybe it's your children. Maybe it's your spouse. But we want to be in control of people. We also like to be in control of circumstances, right? We want everything to look just exactly right. We want our houses to be perfect. We want our kids to go out in public and just act perfect in every single way. Three kids, but they were all pastors' kids. Boy, a lot of pressure. Being the pastor, you better be right. You better be right. You know, we want to control our schedules. We want to control the schedules of people that we love. We want to control what people think about us. We want to control people, and we want to control circumstances. And why do we want to be in control? Because our ego is out of control. Because we believe that we know what's best. We're godlike in our circumstances, and we're godlike. In fact, Ken Blanchard puts it this way. Ego could stand for edging God out. We kind of just, I got this, God. Just move to the side here a little bit. I know what's right, but I'm just going to force it. I'm not going to trust God with it. I'm just going to make sure that it happens. I'm going to just edge God out. In fact, there's a couple verses in Scripture about this. Here's one. I'm not sure if you know this verse. Next slide. It says, blessed are those who give up control of the remote control. Maybe that's a big issue in your house. I try to give it. Lynn, take the remote. You pick something. But there's also this verse put in there in your scripture for it. We can look at this together. It's Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6. It's in the CFV version here. It's how the theme verse goes. It says, trust in the Lord with some of your heart and lean on your own understanding. In some of your ways, acknowledge God. And what's going to happen? You will make your path straight. That's the CFV version, the control freak version. Some of you may have heard, been around the church or the Bible for a while and said, that sounds reasonable. That sounds right to me. Isn't that right? I'll tell you honestly, that's not the real translation. The real translation says we should trust in God with all of our heart. Not lean on our own understanding, but in all of our ways, we should acknowledge God and He will make our paths straight. See, the more we try to control something, the more we fear losing control. And the more we fear losing control, the more we try to control. And suddenly we're in this cycle of fear. Some of you may be thinking, I wish old so-and-so was listening because they really need to hear this. Well, I wish so-and-so was here because this is for them. And the big challenge for us is to look in the mirror and see sometimes it's about us. I swear I need to have like a rearview mirror right here I'm preaching to me too. This is for me. We legitimize what we think is best. I got this. We edge God out. We don't even realize it. So I want to give you an example from Scripture of a control gone bad. Right? When it's just these two people, originally named Abram and Sarai, who became Abraham and Sarah. And they both have this tremendous problem, like most of us. They want to control the outcome of certain situations. Now, if you're not familiar with this story, God said to these two people, Abraham and Sarah, He said to them, I'm going to bless you. You're going to have so many descendants. It's going to be more than the sands on the seashore or stars in the sky. I'm going to bless you with a tremendous legacy, with a beautiful family. And God promises this couple, who for years were unable to conceive, said, I'm going to give you a son. Trust me on this. And so He gives them this incredible, wonderful promise. But when God didn't immediately do what God said and promised to do over time, Abraham and Sarah did what so many of us could do. They try to take control. I'm sick of waiting on you, God. I'm going to do my own thing here. So we see listed there in your program, your message notes. It says, now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne no children, but she had an Egyptian maidservant named Hagar. So she said to Abram, the Lord has kept me from having children. Go sleep with my maidservant. Perhaps I can build a family through her. In other words, I know God promised, but He's not doing it in my time. Therefore, I'm going to control this situation because I know what's best. I'm going to edge God out, and I'm going to take control. Now, there are two things to remember from the story, two things you should never forget. Here's number one. Whatever you do, never, ever, ever sleep with a woman named Hagar. That's number one. Number two, don't ever forget rule number one, right? Abram broke both of those rules. And this is what the story says. It says, Abram agreed to what Sarai said. So after Abram had been living in Canaan for 2 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian servant Hagar, gave her to her husband to be his wife. He slept with Hagar, and she conceived. She slept with Abram, and they conceived the child. And when you edge God out of your life, it is impossible to describe all the chaos that can happen. We want to take control of things, not just our life, but what Abraham and Sarah did has resonated for centuries and centuries later. Hagar gave birth to a son named Ishmael. Sarah later gave birth to a child named Isaac. So you have the trouble between Abram and Sarah and Hagar is immense. But Ishmael became known as the leader of the Palestine people. And Isaac became the leader of the Jewish people. And so you have these Palestinians and these Jewish children who begin to fight centuries and centuries ago. And if you look at the paper today, who's fighting still? The Palestinians and the Jews. They're still fighting centuries later. Descendants of Isaac, descendants of Ishmael. Still at war, still chaos. And it all traces back to a couple who tried to take control and just edge God out. Now, maybe you're sitting here this morning and you're thinking, well, I understand that. But I'm never going to sleep with my maidservant Hagar. In fact, I don't even have a maidservant, right? It doesn't apply to me. But maybe, just maybe, you're a single woman and that clock is ticking and you love Jesus and you want a Christian man, but there's no Christian men around. So you just settle for a man. And you say, it's good enough for now. I'll try to make this work. And you'll force something. You'll manipulate it. You'll compromise. And you settle for something that's less than what God's best is. Because I'm just going to take control. I'm sick of waiting. I'm just going to do my own thing. We're tired of waiting on you, God. You're taking too long. Edge you up. Or maybe financially. Right? Maybe you're a strong follower of Jesus. You know that the tithe belongs to the Lord, to the church, but you rationalize, you compromise, you take control, you say, well, maybe we'll do that later when we're out of debt, or maybe we're not going to do that at all, and you take control of something that really belongs to God, your money, and you edge God out. Or maybe you want something, you just want it really badly, and you know you can't afford it, so you decide to borrow, and you make a very bad long-term decision for a short-term benefit because you're edging God out. You're going to make it happen one way or the other because I really want this. So maybe here's the big application question for each of us. And I want you to just ask yourself and be very honest and write something down in your notes. Confess it to your spouse. Talk about it with those you love. Here's the question. What are you trying to control? What is it you're trying to control? Is it people? Is it your children? Maybe it's your grown children. Maybe it's your coworkers. Maybe it's your image. Maybe it's what people think about you. Just maybe go ahead and write something out. What am I trying to control? Maybe it's my spouse. Just write something down, or you can sit back and say, I'm not doing this stupid exercise. This is just dumb. I'm not going to write anything down. I'm not going to do it, and that's fine. You just kind of prove my point. Take control. What are we trying to control? When you identify that in your life, I want to give you three questions you can ask yourself to see, to really help you understand and believe what's happening. So when you're trying to take control of something, you're trying to edge God out, here's question number one you can ask. Is it worth my concern? Next slide. Is it worth my concern? Back one time, Jesus was visiting the house of Mary and Martha, and Martha was trying to control something that really didn't matter that much, right? She wanted everything perfect, and she's freaking out. She's saying, Jesus, get Mary, my sister, to help me. She's lazy. She's not doing anything. Help her do what I want her to do, Lord. Jesus looks at her and says to Martha, Martha, you're worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, will not be taken away from her. You shouldn't be upset about this. It's not that big a deal. Just let it go. We're trying to control things that don't matter much, that a month from now are not going to matter one bit. And so I wonder, does it really matter if someone doesn't fold the towels just right? Just set somebody free right there. I can feel it. Believe me, I've had this discussion because we have to fold the towels not half, but in thirds so they fit this way in the true story. Does it really matter if your grade school son goes off to school and his hair is not combed perfectly? Is that going to affect his chance to get into Syracuse or Duke, or is that going to cast him into hell? No. So does it really matter? You don't like your child's haircut. Does it really matter if your wife borrows your vehicle and it comes back and there's trash inside the car? Right? Does it really matter? Well, yes, Pastor Brad, it really matters. No, it doesn't. Just let it go. Loosen up. It's not that big a deal. Is it worth my concern to get all upset and having a fight because there's a Kleenex? No, let it go. Ask yourself, are you trying to control something that's not really worth your concern? Let it go. But they do it. They're not doing what I wanted to do. I can't control it. It's okay. Let it go. It's not a big deal. Second question we can ask ourselves is this. Is it mine to control? Is it mine to control? And the answer is sometimes yes. Yes, it is yours to control. There's something you can do about it. There's other times the answer is just no. Because surrendering control, hear me, surrendering control is not the same thing as relinquishing responsibility. Not the same thing. Two different things. You should still be responsible when you can. For example, say you messed up financially. Can you do something about that? Your credit is a wreck and you've got all kinds of debt. Is there something you can do about it? Absolutely you can. Start cutting back on your spending. You can learn to budget. You get some financial advice. You can cut up your credit cards. You can do something about that. If your marriage is messed up, can you do something about that? Absolutely. Right? You try praying together. You can initiate counseling. You can start taking responsibility for your mistakes. You can have date nights together. You can certainly do something about that. That's worth your concern. But there are some other things you just can't control. And you're going to have to understand and acknowledge this reality. You don't control it. In fact, James chapter 4, verses 13 and 14 shows us very clearly. You do not know what your life will be like tomorrow. You're just a vapor that appears for a little while and is gone. You don't even know what's going to happen tomorrow. You can't control that. How do you control what happens 5 years, 10 years, 50 years? You can't. You got to let that stuff go. You think you can plan everything, control everything. The truth is you can't. We can put slides together for a worship service. Computer doesn't work. I can't control that. It's okay. Just let it go. So you ask yourself, is it my concern? Is it worth my concern? Is it mine to control? That's number two. Here's number three. Is it for God alone? Is it for God alone? Paul told the Philippians something very powerful that Art read for us earlier. Philippians chapter 4. Do not be anxious about anything. How many of you are anxious about something? Right? Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. You give it to God. You trust it to the Lord. You lay down your concern to God. You surrender it to Him. And when you do, Scripture says that the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus our Lord. I love that. So many of us, our ego, we're trying to control stuff, and we get stressed out and worried and anxious and consumed with fear because we're trying to control something that's really for God alone. And when you just surrender that to God, God, I can't control this. I can't fix this. This is out of my hand. I've done all that I can. We trust it to God, and God gives you peace. So here's the application question. Can you change your spouse, yes or no? No, you can't. Some of you, it's not a trick question, right? You cannot do that. Well, I think I can, but you can't. You can't change your spouse. You can love your spouse, you can pray for your spouse, you can encourage your spouse, but you can't change your spouse. So what do you do when your spouse needs changing, right? You love them, you pray for them, you trust them to God. You stop trying to control them and you trust them to God. Can you heal a loved one who's sick, yes or no? No, you can't. Can you love them, pray for them, take care of them, get good medical advice? Absolutely. You trust them to God and His peace, which guards your heart, will give you understanding. Can you control the future of your children or the future of anyone that you love? But they're throwing their lives away. They're getting married. They're taking this job. They're moving. You can pray. You can plan. You can give wise counsel. You can make wise decisions, but does God control the future of those you love? Yes. And if that answer is yes, then you give that to God. The thing that Abraham wanted most in the whole world was a son. And God gave him that son. And then God asked him to sacrifice the thing that was most important in his life, his own son. And so as Abraham is walking with his son Isaac up to this mountaintop, Isaac asks his dad, "Hey, Dad, where's the sacrifice? What are we going to offer to God?" And Abraham says, "The Lord will provide." And they got up there, and he's ready to lay his son on the altar. And he looks over and sees a ram stuck in the thicket. He takes the lamb, he offers it to God as a sacrifice. God blesses him. And Abraham calls that place, "The Lord will provide." You see, when you give what matters most to you, the thing that you most love, when you give it to God, God will provide. "Lord, I can't control this marriage. I can't control this person. I can't control this situation. I give it to God. And I trust that his peace will endure. It'll be enough." What are you trying to control? You need to ask, is it mine to control? Is it worth my concern? Is it for God alone? Don't worry, but trust and obey. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you for your word, which is truth. I thank you for your messages, which continue to remind us that you are for us, not against us. You are in control of all things. That we edge you out, we push you out to the margins, and we try to fix and control people and things, and it leaves us frustrated and anxious. Lord, give us peace in that time, that we would no longer try to control things. Take responsibility, certainly, but not control the outcomes. That's up to you. We ask it would be so in Jesus' name. Amen. Closing hymn, appropriately enough, you can remember the chorus here, "God will take care of you." Let's stand and sing if you're able.
God will take care of you.
That's the refrain we should hang on to. Remember that God will take care of you and those that you love and those circumstances you're concerned about. Yeah, I want things to happen. I want it to all be, but it's not mine to control. It's His. So offer those things to His and enjoy some peace. Be blessed as you go. Thanks for coming. Have a great week. Stay cool, y'all. Thanks. Peace.